What industry do you hope won't exist as soon? Story 1. Exploitative student loan consultants. During my time working as a federal student loan collector for a Department of Education contractor, I encountered distressing stories of borrowers who fell victim to deceptive third-party consultants. The most egregious case involved a borrower who believed that a consolidation service she paid for would completely absolve her of her obligations. These individuals operate in a legal gray area and exploit people by offering assistance with paperwork for a fee. Despite including fine print disclosures, their predatory practices deeply disturb me. Personally, I experienced the harrowing consequences of student loan debt. Over the course of 2 years, I paid a staggering $25,000 to rehabilitate a $5,000 student loan. Initially, I was overjoyed, thinking that my debt had been cleared. However, to my dismay, I discovered that not only was I still far from being debt-free, but my balance had actually ballooned to $38,000. It's a long and disheartening story, further compounded by my proximity to retirement age. In fact, Social Security has already notified me that my benefits will be withheld to repay my loans. In the early 1980s, after graduating from high school, I enrolled in a state university with the help of a $5,000 student loan. Unfortunately, I had to drop out because of severe bouts of depression during finals week. Back then, mental illness carried a significant stigma, forcing me to find employment instead. I faithfully paid $75 per month until 1991 when a recession hit, and I lost my job because of my employer's closure. Facing unemployment, I contacted the company responsible for servicing my student loan on behalf of the government. I explained my situation, expressing my inability to continue paying $75 and proposed a reduced payment between $35 and $50 per month. Their response was a resounding no, leaving no room for discussion. $75 represented nearly a month's worth of groceries for me, so I made the hard decision to cease payments and defaulted on the loan. In the United States, ignoring a student loan is not an option. Once it enters default, your credit score plummets, and the government imposes restrictions such as denying other loan applications, withholding tax returns, and more until the debt is repaid. Even bankruptcy doesn't discharge student loan debt. However, the government hands over defaulted accounts to professional credit collection agencies, and buried within the fine print is a clause allowing these agencies to charge borrowers for collection costs. To evade the collection agency's clutches, I dodged their attempts for a decade. However, this evasion came at a price. Tanked credit ratings made it difficult for me to find work as a bookkeeper, as employers frequently checked credit history during background checks, assuming financial hardship correlated with dishonesty. I settled for low-paying jobs to make ends meet. At some point, I decided I had had enough and yearned to return to college. Since my husband is a disabled veteran, I could receive assistance from the VA to cover my education costs. I eagerly enrolled and thoroughly enjoyed my studies. Then, one day, when the collection agency called, I actually listened. I believed I could afford the $200 monthly payment they requested, assuming it wouldn't take long to pay off the remaining balance, which I thought was a mere fraction of the original loan. However, my assumptions were wrong. Due to accrued interest and penalties, I spent another 5 years making $200 monthly payments. Eventually, I received a letter stating that my loan had been rehabilitated, leading me to believe it had been fully settled. Regrettably, about a month later, the Department of Education sent me a notice stating that my loan had indeed been rehabilitated, meaning I was no longer in default, but I still owed a staggering $38,000. When I inquired about the payments I had made during the rehabilitation period, they informed me that those were merely collection costs. Frustrated, I sought assistance from the DOE, the bank, the collection agency, and even a lawyer, only to be told that it was my fault for defaulting and that I had no grounds to challenge the situation. The new payment plan required me to pay $496 per month, surpassing my monthly income. Fortunately, due to changes in the rules, I qualified for an income-based repayment plan, which would have been a blessing back in 1991, but that's a different story. For several more years, I paid $128 per month, until my physical condition deteriorated to the point of being unable to work because of arthritis. At 54 years old, I had to undergo a knee replacement surgery because of the overall poor health of my joints. My income-based payment plan reduced to zero, causing the loan balance to grow due to accumulating interest. The COVID-19 pandemic struck, leaving me unemployed since 2020. To summarize, I estimate that I have paid approximately $25,000 towards a loan that was originally $5,000, yet I still owe $38,000 or more. Student loans have utterly devastated my life. When my husband passes away, I will be left with virtually nothing. A lifetime plagued by mental illness, poor credit, and low-paying jobs has left me with no savings or future Social Security benefits. This is the reality of America. It deeply saddens me that in a country like this, a decision made at 20 to pursue a better future can derail one's entire life and lead to ruination. The state of college education in America is an utter mess. Even if you aspire to a career requiring a degree, getting that degree becomes nearly impossible for parents who can afford to pay for it. I empathize with young individuals whose parents refuse to assist them with college expenses, unaware that student loans are no longer a viable option for many. Story 2. Simplifying U.S. tax preparation, eliminating unnecessary middlemen. The influence of lobbying and bribery in the tax industry has created a situation where many individuals, including myself, feel compelled to use professional tax services. However, for the average taxpayer, there should be a better alternative, particularly considering the complexities and ever-changing nature of the government's tax system. Speaking as a tax preparer, I agree that individuals who work regular jobs and receive wage income shouldn't have to go through the hassle of filing a tax return in the age of advanced computer systems. Employers should be able to withhold the correct amount of taxes, simplifying the process for taxpayers. Such a system would save the IRS both time and resources while sparing countless individuals from unnecessary frustration. Many other countries have already adopted this approach. Of course, individuals with rental income, self-employment income, and similar situations would still need to file tax returns. Story 3. Unmasking MLMs and pyramid schemes. A few years ago, a friend introduced me to one of these schemes, and upon calculating the number of people involved at just the 7th level, I realized it exceeded the global population. When I pointed this out to my friend, their response was unsettling. They simply didn't care as long as they benefited, even if it meant exploiting their friends. It's disheartening to lose respect for someone after such a revelation. I have a cousin and his wife who are currently entangled in one of these schemes. Extensive research led me to understand that once someone becomes involved, it's incredibly challenging to extricate them unless they are open to receiving help. The most effective approach is to educate individuals about the structure and flaws of MLMs before they become ensnared. I sat down with my other cousins and explained how companies like Amway operate, emphasizing the fact that the primary way to make money in such schemes is by roping in more unsuspecting individuals. The parallels to a virus are truly unsettling. Story 4. The concert ticket monopoly, Ticketmaster, StubHub, Live Nation. Ticketmaster, StubHub, and Live Nation have effectively monopolized the concert ticket market. A few years ago, I experienced firsthand the frustrations of trying to purchase concert tickets. The venue had implemented a system to prevent scalpers from acquiring a significant number of tickets. I diligently logged into the website at the designated time and spent an hour and a half refreshing the page. By the time I gained access, only one ticket remained. Interestingly, it was the Ticketmaster who had already begun advertising tickets. The venue likely reserved only a few tickets for sale on their platform, while secretly allocating the majority to Ticketmaster. Ticketmaster thrives on this business model, playing the role of the villain while allowing venues to charge higher prices discreetly. Although not all the fees go directly to Ticketmaster, as they are shared with the venue, many artists also receive a portion. Ticketmaster has grown so dominant that it now owns many venues. Story 5. The pitfalls of 24-hour propaganda disguised as news. There is a compelling argument for the world to do away with 24-hour news channels for several reasons, with sensationalism being a primary concern. In order to keep viewers engaged, these channels often prioritize sensational stories, leading to a distorted perception of reality. Constant exposure to negative news can generate anxiety and stress, which can have detrimental effects on mental and physical well-being. Without the pressure to fill 24 hours of airtime, news channels could dedicate more time to in-depth reporting and analysis, fostering thoughtful and nuanced discussions. The need to generate breaking news stories often results in inaccuracies or misleading information. With additional time available, news channels could place greater emphasis on positive news and developments, thereby presenting a more balanced and accurate view of the world. It is important to acknowledge that 24-hour news channels also have their merits, particularly in providing real-time information during emergencies. However, it is crucial to weigh the drawbacks against the benefits when considering the role of these channels. Thank you for your attention. If you have your own story to share, please leave it in the comments. I would love to explore them in future videos. Don't forget to like and subscribe to more content like this. Visit our channel now. Once again, Thank you, and see you next time.